All right. Good morning, church family. How are we doing this morning? How are you guys doing with the time change? Doing okay? Doing okay? Have a little bit of energy this morning? I'm telling you, I was up, you know, I was up at 5 o'clock this morning, and then really it felt like 4 o'clock because obviously the time change. So yeah, so all that being said, I don't have a lot of energy this morning. So that means I need your help to bring the energy this morning. Is that something we could do, church? Kinda. Okay, we're still waking up. That's fine. Well, these songs I think will wake you up this morning. But let's get excited. We're praising the Lord together, right? Amen. Amen. All right, let's stand up and praise the name of the Lord together. We are an ocean of your grace. We're gathered unto one name. We are a tide that's rising, and we cannot be contained. We're gathered unto one name. Church, come on, with all heaven sing, with all heaven sing, and all earth be low, one holy day, one highest soul, come on, with all heaven sing, and all earth. God, for a thousand times to say the glories of our Lord, God Almighty. Oh, to see the Savior's grace, the triumph of His grace, you are worthy, you are worthy, God. Darkness has to retreat.
one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. In just one touch, my eyes were open and see. My heart can now but believe.
Come on.
There's nothing that I got can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't burn. Well, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I got can't do. Just one word, you hear it broken.
Clothed in love and strength. Sing out. You guys can go ahead and be seated. Hey, I am so blessed this morning. Oh, first of all, kids, you can go to River Ridge Kids. He was looking at me like, okay. It's so good to be here with you, my new church family, and also here with some of my old church family, Jaira. So if you guys could all welcome Jaira. Thanks so much, Jaira, for coming this morning. I know she doesn't like that I did that, but that's okay. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Brian. I'm one of the pastors here at River Ridge Church. If you're new here, and I see some new people, welcome. We're so blessed to have you here. I want to tell you a few things about our church. First of all, we're a church that's very welcoming. We love people, and so we're so excited that you're here and that you've come and chosen to worship with us. But we're also a church that really truly believes that as we come together, God does something in us. He does a work in us, and each of us comes here with a next step that we have with God. Every single one of us, we have a next step with God right now, right here, right now. I was just thinking about that song where it says that he is a strong God. And it reminded me of what Scripture says, that he uses the weak to confound the wise. That's literally something that God was speaking to me this morning. And I was just so encouraged with that. So see, we all have a step. There's just things that God is constantly teaching us. And we're a church that wants to help you to learn what your next step is in your walk with God. Also, we're a church that loves to reach out to our community, and we do that in various ways. And we're a church that plants churches, and we'll talk more about that a little bit later on. But just want to draw your attention to the screen. We have some contact cards up there that should come up on the screen. The first is a smaller card. So if you're here, and let's just say you want to get together with one of the pastors, maybe you have questions for one of us, we would love to meet with you, and we would love to have a cup of coffee with you if that's what you'd like, or just to answer any questions you might have. Please fill that card out. We will get back to you this week. The second card is a bigger card, and that's for those of you who say, you know what, I want to make this church my church home. I'd like to be added to the email distribution list, and we'll keep you informed as to everything that's going on. So after the service, if you could get one of those cards, fill that out, leave it back there, we'll contact you right away. Well, church, let's go ahead and say a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you, God, so much for this church, and thank you, God, for the gathering of the saints, Lord. Your holy ones, the ones that are set apart, weak people whom you have made strong, Lord. Thank you so much for every person that's here. Thank you, God, for River Ridge Church and for the way you've provided so faithfully, so graciously, God, for our church. Thank you, Lord, that you are realizing through this church the vision that you have for this church, God, and that we're seeing it and we get to be a part of that, Lord. What a blessing that is, God. We thank you for worship. We thank you, Lord, that we still live in a country where we can do this. We know there are many people throughout the world that can't even do this, God. They have to hide to do this. So, God, we thank you, Lord, for the freedoms that you've afforded to us. And we ask, God, that you'd continue to protect those freedoms in this country. And, Lord, we just ask, God, that this morning you would help us to take our next step with you, God. That, Lord, you would speak through Pastor Rick now, Lord, as he shares your word. And that it would impact our lives, that we would not only be hearers of what your word says, but God, make us doers of your word. And help us, Lord, through this time to love you with our whole heart, our whole soul, our whole mind, and all of our strength, Lord. Unto your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. Promises in fulfillment all of my life, all of my life. Sing it out. Help me remember when I'm weak. If fear may come, but fear believe. You lead my heart to. You are my strength, and you always will be. Come on. I see the evidence of your goodness Because of your goodness all of my life, all of my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all of my life, all of my life. Should I fear? Come on. Oh, why should I fear? The evidence is here. One more time. Why should I fear? Oh, why should I fear? Oh, the evidence is here.
Set up for today's message, which is the evidence of being a Christian. So if you would all stay standing while we read today's scripture, it's 1 John 1, 6-7. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all of our sin. You may be seated. So we're about halfway through a series called Affirming Our Faith Through the Apostles' Creed. A lot of us will remember reciting the creed when we were younger, but sometimes we get in the mode where we're just kind of saying the words and then just regurgitating them and not really knowing what exactly it is we're praying. So in this preaching series, Pastor Carrie and Pastor Brian have been breaking down the Apostles' Creed line by line so that each week we spend time understanding what the words really mean and what our faith is. You know, I remember when Pastor Carrie took the same approach not long ago with the Lord's Prayer, and when understanding that when we say, "Thy will be done," is really a submission to God's omniscience and power, and understanding that "lead us not into temptation" is asking God to keep us from submitting to temptation, it really had a huge impact on me, and it changed the way I said that prayer from then on in. And I think the same thing will happen with the Apostles' Creed. So for the last few messages in this current series, we talked about what Jesus did for us and the price that he paid to save us from our sins and assign his righteousness to us. And that helps us to not just say the words, but to fully understand what it is we believe and what the foundation of our faith is. So today I want to take a slight detour from the series, and I want to talk about what it means to be a Christian and follow Jesus. You know, just as we want to fully understand the words in the Apostles' Creed and Lord's Prayer, it's really important for us to know what we mean when we say, "I'm a Christian." So, let me start out by asking you a question. If you were arrested and charged with being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about four bodies of evidence that a judge or jury would use to determine if that accusation is founded. But let's lay a foundation first and talk about the definition of a Christian. So there was a Pew Research study from 2021 that revealed that 69% of Americans claimed to be Christians. And by the way, in the early 90s, that number was more like 90%. So we've had like a 30% drop in people that say they're a Christian. Now, the question I have for you is, if in fact 69% of our country were really Christians, do you think that our country would be in the state of moral decay that we're in today, with abortion, with redefining gender, with redefining marriage, with violence, with racism, with corruption? It sure doesn't seem like it if that number really were Christians. And yet it's interesting that only 9% of those who identify as Christians really possess a biblical worldview, believing that the Bible is accurate and reliable in the Word of God. And there's another study by Barna Research that says 51% of U.S. adults claim to have a biblical worldview. So think about that gap. 51% claim to have a worldview, only 9% really do. So there's a huge gap in what people think the Bible teaches and what it really does teach. Let me give you a couple data points from that study. Only 61% of those who identify as Christians believe that God is all-knowing, all-powerful, perfect, and the just creator of the universe. 72% argue that people are basically good. 66% say that having faith matters a lot more than which faith it is you have. And 58% believe that if a person is good enough and does enough good things, they can earn their way to heaven. So Jan and I used to attend a church in California called Venture Christian Church. And Chip Ingram was the pastor out there. And he used to call certain Christians cafeteria Christians. He'd say they pick parts of the Bible that they want to believe in, and the parts that don't align with the way they want to live their lives, they just dismiss. So he called them cafeteria Christians. Most of you probably know a comedian named Jeff Foxworthy, right? He's this great comedian who used the you might be a redneck if. So as I was preparing for this message, I saw a note from a pastor in South Carolina that had a little fun with his model and said, you might be a Christian if. And let me share just a couple things he said. He said, you might be a Christian if you eat at Chick-fil-A at least once a week. Or if your home looks like a Hobby Lobby ad. Or you might be a Christian if you accidentally said amen after saying the Pledge of Allegiance. Or if you switch channels on the TV for most commercials. You might be a Christian if you sometimes use the word fellowship in a sentence. Or if your dog's named after someone in the Bible. And one more for those football fans out there. You might be a Christian if you think Tim Tebow was the best quarterback that ever played. So let's look at the definition of a Christian. Webster defines it as one who professes belief in the teachings of Jesus Christ. Now, that's a great starting point, but it falls way short of the biblical truth of what it means to be a Christian. You know, unfortunately, over time, the word Christian's lost a great deal of significance, and it often refers to someone who's religious or just has high moral values. George Barna will say that the word Christian has become somewhat of a generic term rather than a name that reflects a deep commitment to passionately pursuing and being like Jesus Christ. You know, in fact, many people don't necessarily believe and trust in Jesus Christ, but they still consider themselves Christians simply because they go to church or they live in a Christian nation. But going to church, serving others, believing in God, being a good person, those are all great things, but they don't necessarily make you a Christian. You know, just as we taught, the Apostles' Creed states what we believe, but it's not good enough to just believe it. You know, even non-believers will agree that Jesus Christ was a historical figure. But we believe he was the Son of God, and we believe that he's our Savior. So what we believe has to drive our actions and behaviors. So what's the definition of a true Christian? Followers of Jesus Christ were first called Christians in Antioch. You can look it up in Acts 11:26, because their behavior, their activity, and their speech were like Christ. The word Christian literally means belonging to the party of Christ or a follower of Christ. That's what it means. So a true Christian is a person who has put faith and trust in the person and works of Jesus Christ, including his death at the cross for payment of our sins and his resurrection on the third day. John 1:12 will tell us, yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. The mark of a true Christian is love for others and obedience to God's word. A true Christian is indeed a child of God, a part of God's true family, and one who's been given new life in Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible also teaches us that good works alone don't make us acceptable to God. Titus 3:5 says, he saved us not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. So a Christian is someone who's been born again by God and has put faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:8 tells us that it's by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not the result of your works. It's a gift from God. And Luke 9:23 tells us that whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up my cross daily and follow me. You know, when someone comes up to you, meets you for the first time, there's a lot of ways that you can identify yourself. I can say I'm an accountant, but that's basically what I do. Or I can say I'm a father, but that's a role that I have. Or I can say I'm an Italian, but that's my heritage or my DNA. But when I say I'm a Christian, I'm defining who I am. All of those other responses are subject to some preconceived perceptions and, in fact, some interpretation. So I remember when I told people I was going to be an accountant, they said, you can't be an accountant. You talk too much and you have too much personality. You can't do that. Fathers. Some fathers really focus on financially providing for their family and others focus more on nurturing their children. Italians are supposed to be romantic, but I destroyed that stereotype 40 years ago when I proposed to my wife. So I took her out for a nice dinner. I had the ring in my pocket. I was just waiting for that perfect moment to get down on the knee and look in her eyes and tell her how much I loved her and wanted to spend the rest of my life with her. So we were done with the meal, and I looked at her, and I said, hey, by the way, if I were to ask you to marry me, what would you say? Not real romantic, right? And I protected myself, too, because if she said no, I would have just said, well, I was just wondering. And if she said yes, I was ready to whip the ring out, right? When we say we're a Christian, though, there's no wiggle room in what that means. The Bible's perfectly clear, and Jesus taught us by example what it means to be a Christian, to follow him. And that doesn't mean we fall short sometimes. It doesn't mean we mess up, but it's clear what it means to be a Christian. So let me get back to the question I asked at the beginning. If you were arrested and charged with being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? So in a trial, a defense attorney would present specific evidence on your behalf. And I want to talk about four different bodies of evidence that would support the claim of being a Christian. And I'm going to use a series of questions to do that. So, slide number one. Physical evidence of your behaviors and actions. How do you live day to day? Do you live as if Jesus could return tomorrow? You know, I've often asked people, if you knew positively that Jesus was returning tomorrow, what would you do differently? And the right answer ought to be nothing, right? We ought to always be ready for Jesus' return. Are you in God's Word regularly? A 2023 Pew Research study reveals that only 35% of people read Scripture at least once a week, and 45% say they never read it. Are you in church or meeting with other Christians regularly? Hebrews 10:24-25 says, "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." I saw another survey that said U.S. adults who say they generally attend religious services once a month has dropped to 30% in 2022. Do you talk about your faith with family and friends, even if they're not followers of Jesus? Do you take a firm position as a Christian without fear of cultural or political pressure? You know, we're living in a really divided country right now. And if the cancel culture puts you at a risk if you dare to not fall in line with mainstream thinking. Do you pray before eating, even if you're in public? Do you volunteer and tithe? You know, I've always said that I only need two pieces of evidence to know what's important to you, your checkbook and your calendar, because people spend their time and money on what's important to them. Do you reflect your faith by doing good works? Another survey I looked at said that only 23% of U.S. people over 16 volunteered during 2023 through an organization. Now, of course, remember that good works alone does not make you a Christian, but if you're a Christian, you want to affirm your faith by good works. The Bible teaches us that faith is living and active, and if we don't have accompanying works, then faith's dead. Matthew 5:16 tells us, "In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Do you generally love others? We've got two pastors that it's obvious just love people in general. 1 Corinthians 13:1-3 teaches us that if I speak in the tongues of men and angels but have not love, I'm just a noisy gong or clanging cymbal. And I have prophetic powers and understand the mysteries and knowledge. And if I have all faith as to move mountains, but I have not love, I'm nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. So let's move on to evidence number two. Witnesses or interactions with others. You know, a lawyer would call witnesses to the stand to talk about your character and your relationships. So, here we go. How many people that you come in contact with would testify that they see godly characteristics in you, in the way you behave? Are you the same person in Walmart that you are when you're in the church? You know, there's a famous scene in The Godfather where Michael Corleone is in church baptizing a baby, right? I mean, a very religious scene. Everyone's around. Outside, he's having all the five heads of the families hit. You know, inside the church, good Christian behavior. Outside, not so much. I remember in my neighborhood, I used to, when I'm walking or driving, if I see somebody that I recognize coming by, you know, I'll wave to them. I remember a couple times somebody would go by and wave, and I didn't wave back because I didn't recognize them. And I went home and felt really guilty about it. And all of a sudden it hit me. You thought, what difference does it make if you know them or not? Just wave. Just be friendly and love people. How do others perceive your actions? Are you considered to be loving and considerate or self-centered? Do you think of others before yourself? You know, we're in a culture today that really seems to stress a me-first attitude and whatever makes me happy. But Christians are different. They think of others first. Are you kind and thoughtful or selfish and angry? When we walk in the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit are reflective of who we are. You know, a fig tree can't produce a different kind of fruit. The fruit's reflective of what the tree is. So Galatians 5, 22 to 23 tells us that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And against such things there's no law. Is that what people see when they interact with you? You know, sometimes I might say something or about somebody or something that's going on that doesn't necessarily show kindness and love, and it certainly doesn't show self-control. And Jan, my wife, will just turn around to me and say, okay, Pastor Rick, three simple words will bring me back to reality. She doesn't have to lecture me. She just has to remind me. How do you deal with adversity? You know, it's easy to be faithful when everything's going well for you. Remember the story of Job, Job 1, 8 to 11. And the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there's none like him on the earth, a blameless man who fears God and turns away from evil? And then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he owns? You've blessed the work of his hands and his possessions have increased. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he'll curse you to your face. See, non-Christians watch the way Christians behave and react to problems. And if every time we have a small problem, we freak out, non-Christians are saying, how strong can your faith be? Is it only strong when things are going well? Do you trust God all the time? Do your actions reflect your words and belief? When I was 9 years old, someone picked a fight with me. I grew up in a Catholic church, so I backed away and I said, I don't fight, I'm a Catholic. Well, you can imagine the grief I took from that, from my father who was a boxer and never lost a match, and my brother who was a clone of my father. But I truly believed back then that you don't fight. And so I wasn't being a coward, I just truly believe that's not what Catholics do. There was a poll in a church in 2021 that revealed a huge gap between how believers see themselves and how others see them. I want to share a couple of data points of that. Only 20% of Christians in that poll felt that they were hypocritical. 55% of non-believers thought that about them. 71% of Christians considered themselves compassionate, while only 15% of other religious groups and 12% of non-believers thought Christians were compassionate. 60% of evangelicals consider themselves honest. 7% of non-religious and 11% of other religions believe that. So there's a huge gap in how we perceive ourselves and how others perceive us. And a lot of it's based on how we behave. Let's move on to evidence number 3. Your testimony. So in Acts 1:8, Jesus tells us, you will receive power from the Holy Spirit that has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Could others give specific evidence of when you acted like a Christian? So not long ago, I was hitting the back end of my truck while I was sitting at a stoplight. I didn't do anything wrong. I was stopped. The person just wasn't paying attention and ran into the back end. And I was furious. a policeman pulled us over into a lot. And while I was sitting in the car and he was on the phone, I was stewing, just waiting to lay into this guy. So as I got out of the car and walked towards him, out of the corner of my eye, I see the River Ridge decal in the window of my truck. And I thought, I think he saw that when he hit me in the back end, right? And immediately God convicted me, and the anger was gone. So we met, he started apologizing. I'm really sorry, it was my fault. I said, it's okay, things happen. By then, if God had not spoken to me, I would have gone crazy. Second time he said, you know, I'm sorry, it was an accident, I wasn't paying attention. Again, I said, hey, it's okay, it happens. The third time he apologized, I said, look, I serve as a pastor up the road. What kind of Christian would I be if I went nuts and treated you unkindly over a minor accident? None of us were hurt. The cars will get repaired. But again, God convicted me, or that would have not ended well. But that's just the beginning of it. It gets worse. The guy fixed the car, and he said, you're going to be fine as long as you don't get hit in the rear end again. I said, come on, what are the odds of that, right? 2 weeks later, I'm sitting at the stoplight. A kid runs into the back end of me, a 20-year-old kid with no insurance, and now I'm really ready to go off the end. So again, I'm sitting in the car ready to go insane on this guy, and God convicted me again. So as I got out and walked over to him, I simply said to him, Sylvester, I just trust that you'll do the right thing. Well, the car got repaired, and in fact, he paid for it. And when he met me, he said, I just want you to know how much I appreciate that you didn't yell at me. And then he started to tell me how he grew up in a really tough family. His mom and dad have abandoned him. He didn't have anybody in his life. And he asked if I would be willing to meet with him. And I told him about the church, and he said, yeah, I'd like to come there sometime. Well, I haven't heard from him for a while, so a couple weeks ago, I sent him a note, a text, and invited him to Easter, and he wrote back immediately and said, yeah, maybe I'll come to that. But all of that, because God opened the door, because he drove my actions, not me. So I want to be clear, I'm not boasting about my behavior, because in the flesh, I would have gone insane on both of them. But I'm boasting about the Holy Spirit working through me. Amen. How many people could give testimonies of things that you've done? Would anyone call you a hypocrite, or do they speak well of you? In Matthew 25, 31 to 46, Jesus told his followers that whatever they do to the least of his brothers, they do to him. Would people easily recall multiple episodes of how you acted like Christ? Let's move on to the last evidence. Evidence number 4, conversion. How have you lived out the Great Commission? You know, a judge and jury would consider you a really dangerous Christian if you were leading other people to the Lord. And Matthew 28, 18, 20 says, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. How many people have you invited to church? How many have you shared the gospel with? Mark 16, 15 says, and he said to them, go into all of the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. How often have you invited someone to an event or a visit to your home where they might hear about Christ? Do you pray for others, even if you don't know whether they're Christians or not? I have a neighbor, his name is Russ, and he's dealing with prostate cancer. Now, Russ is a really tough guy. He's a retired iron worker. He rides a Harley. I mean, he's just intimidating to even look at. But we became friends. And, you know, each week we meet on a prayer call that Terry Xander Williams leads, where we pray for our country, the world, and people that have specific needs. So we pray for Russ every week for treatment for his cancer. So a couple weeks ago, Russ was driving by. He slowed down to talk to me, and he was looking out. I was on the other side of the car, and he started telling me about the treatment for his cancer. And I said, you know, Russ, I just want you to know that our church is praying for you every week. This big, intimidating guy reached his big paw across the seat, grabbed my hand, wouldn't let go, and started crying. And said, I just want to tell you how much it means that you're praying for me. You know, prayer is powerful. Do people ask you to pray for them, or do you ask them if you can pray for them? I had another neighbor who was dying of liver cancer. I had no relationship or their idea with the Lord, their relation with the Lord. But one day, while I was visiting them, the Lord convicted me to say, "Hey, is it okay if I pray with you?" There was no hesitation. Lois and Dale and I grabbed hands and prayed for comfort and peace. And again, you can't not pray because you don't know how they'll receive it. You just let God do the work. Do people come to you with questions or advice about faith? You know, sometimes we're nervous because we don't have all the answers, but that's okay. We know where to get the answers. And it's an opportunity to minister to someone in need. Do you talk about your faith openly and with conviction without giving a second thought to the cancel culture we're living in today? What would be your legacy? What would others say about you when you go on to eternity? Would they talk about your accomplishments, your material possessions, your career, or your relationship with the Lord? Some of you may have heard of Penn and Teller, a comedy team. They're openly atheists. And so Penn made a comment once that he said, "I don't get you Christians." He said, "You know, if I saw somebody in a road and a bus was bearing down on them, I would do everything in my power to move them out of the way to bring them to safety. If you Christians really believe what you believe, why aren't you doing everything in your power to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and to have people join you in heaven?" It's a great question. Okay, so as I draw this to a close, I'm reminded of Matthew 22, 34, 40. He says, "Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together, and one of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, 'Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?' And Jesus replied, 'Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And this is the first and greatest commandment. And a second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments.'" So all the evidence that we've just reviewed points back to these two commands from Christ. If you're truly a Christian, your beliefs and your actions will show that you love God and that you love others. So is it hard or is it easy to be a Christian? Well, that depends on whether you're walking in the flesh or the spirit. If you're walking in the flesh, it's not hard, it's impossible. Remember Pastor Carey said there are really two ways to get to heaven, right? One of them is to live a perfect, sinless life, and the other is to trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. In the flesh, we serve our own desires. Christian life is impossible to achieve. But the good news is Philippians 4:13 tells us, "I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength." So we've talked today about the difference between saying you're a Christian and actually being one, and understanding what it means to say you're a Christian. Matthew 7:21-23 says, Jesus tells the disciples, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name?' And then I'll declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" You all know who David Jeremiah is, a great preacher, very aligned with our doctrine. He makes an observation that many Christians today are cultural Christians. He said they have Christian habits, they may have had Christian upbringing, and in fact, they perhaps have a lot of biblical knowledge, but they don't really know Jesus Christ. So he interprets the scripture that I just read as Jesus, in effect, saying, "Hey, we didn't have a personal relationship." He said, "You may have been busy doing religious things. You never received me as your personal Savior." And Jeremiah says that if you belong to Christ, you've been called to be the hands and feet of Jesus in the presence of those who have not yet met him. So I believe that when we meet our Lord face to face, we're going to be judged by the same bodies of evidence that we just talked about. Have any of you ever bought a product where they don't have the instructions with it and try to figure it out? You know, I remember my dad doing that, and at the end, there'd always be extra parts all over the place. And I'd say, "What are these?" "Oh, they always give you extra parts." The good news is we have a complete instruction manual right here in the Bible over how to be a Christian. It's perfectly clear when we stay in the Word what it means to follow Jesus Christ. Now, I want to be really clear before I close so no one misunderstands what we're saying here. The only one that was sinless was Jesus Christ. We mess up. We fall short sometimes. Or as Pastor Carey will say, we're just a bunch of messed up Christians trying to mess up less. Even Paul said in Romans 7:15-17, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I don't do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I don't want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is, it's no longer I myself who do it, but a sin living in me. So we mess up, but that doesn't change the definition of what a Christian is, because it's perfectly clear in the Bible and by Jesus' example. We just have to remember that the sanctification process is a lifelong process. And as Paul tells us in Philippians 1:6, being confident in this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. Think for a moment that the jury declares you innocent or guilty of being a Christian. If you're innocent and set free because of a lack of evidence, would you feel relief or would you feel regret? And if you're declared guilty, would you be willing to die for your faith? Because you see, submitting to our Lord and Savior means submitting everything. It means submitting our finances, our career, our family, our relationships, our whole life. Let me pray for us. Father, we take great comfort and peace knowing that your word and the example set by Jesus as a sinless man make it crystal clear what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. We know that in the flesh, it's impossible to live our lives according to your word, but we're so grateful that you've sent the Holy Spirit to live in us. And when we walk in the Spirit, we can do all things through you. We pray that people will see Jesus in us as we continue to run the race, and we look forward to the day when we'll see you face to face and hear you say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And Father, we pray that if there are some of us today who have not yet received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that they would take that step today and invite you into their lives. And we pray all this in the holy and precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we praise the name of the Lord together.
Wonderful name.
could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, and you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand again. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, and now and forever, God, you
church. Just a few announcements before we go. Just a reminder that Holy Week is coming, March 24th through Sunday, March 31st. Good Friday service is on Friday, March 29th at 6:30 here. The topic is going to be Light of the World. It's going to be a great time. And then Easter, obviously, is March 31st at our normal times. And the topic is He is Alive. Also, just want to remind you about the Trevor Church Plant, and a couple, just draw your attention to a few things there. April 7th, we are going to be having a celebration service. We ask that all of you would come, because we are all praying and we are all giving into this church, into this new thing that God is doing. So we want to celebrate what God is doing. That's on April 7th. That's going to be at 5 p.m. And then April 14th, we're going to start our first services. And so for those of you who are going to be coming to the Trevor Church, that's going to be our first service, April 14th. For those of you who are going to be staying here at Spring Grove, you'll be coming here as normal. So we're ready to go. This is exciting. God is doing it, and we're excited about what He's doing. Also, just for, there's a few flyers in the back. There's three different flyers. There's one with both of those dates on them. There's one that just has the date for the celebration service. So maybe there's somebody in this church that you want to give that to that maybe hasn't been coming, so that they can come and celebrate with us. Also, there is a flyer that has just the 14th date. Okay, so we've separated those into three separate flyers so that you can know who to give them to. Guys, if you have neighbors that you think would be blessed to come to this church, please use those as an opportunity to invite them. Also, it's an opportunity for you to do exactly what Rick was just talking to. Reach out to your neighbor. You know, it's amazing how just giving somebody an invitation to something like this can turn into a gospel conversation. So think about that, and we'd love for you to do that. Also, the softball league is going to be coming. We still have a lot of details that need to be worked out, so we don't have registration for that up yet, but that's going to be starting in May. So if you like softball, if you want to play softball, that's coming up. It's for people that are ages 17 and older. Everyone's welcome to this. Doesn't matter how good you are at softball. It's just going to be a great time. Laura and Blaine Barnett are around if you have any questions about that. And lastly, just want to draw your attention to our student ministry. We do have a student ministry here at River Ridge, and they meet every Sunday, 5:30. They meet at the Trevor-Wilmot School. So if you're a parent, or if maybe you know somebody that's grades 6 through 12, it's a great time. They have games, they have fun together, but they also, most importantly, get into the Word. They share testimonies, things like that. So it's just a great time. So just want to remind you about that. If you need prayer, Pastor Rick and I are going to be up here after the service. And you know what? I want to say something in light of what we just heard. Maybe you're here and you'd say, you know what? I don't have enough evidence to prove that I'm a Christian. And we would hate for you to leave here thinking, okay, I got to go be a moral person now. I got to start, you know, responding well when I get rear-ended by another car. I got to start doing these things. I got to start working on this. And actually, that is not the step. We talked about the steps now. We all have a step with God. What's your step? The step for you would be receive the Holy Spirit. Because, as Rick said, it's the fruit of the Spirit in us that produces those things. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We can't do those things apart from God. And so your step would be, Lord Jesus, forgive me a sinner. Receive me to be with you in your kingdom. And I want to pray right now, and I want to lead you in a prayer. And if you're here and you want to pray for that, and you're saying, you know what, I do need to give my life to Christ, let's pray now. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I confess to you that I am a sinner. I'm guilty of all those things that Rick spoke of and far more than that, Lord. And I acknowledge that I don't believe in you and that I don't have the evidence to prove that I'm a Christian, as he said. But God, I want to be. And I realize today, through you speaking to me in your word and through your Holy Spirit working here, I realize today that I need to follow you, God. And so, Lord, I recognize I'm a sinner. And I also recognize, Jesus, that you died on a cross for my sin, and you paid the full penalty for all my sin, and I thank you for that. And I also realize that you rose again from the dead, and I believe that you rose again from the dead, and that you're now seated at the right hand of the Father. And God, I want to follow you, and I don't know what my next step is, but God, I know that this is my step right now, that I need to trust in you. And so I today say I'm going to follow you, God. I want to follow you. Would you help me by your Spirit, and help me to begin to walk this walk with you, in Jesus' name, amen. All right, church, now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace, church.